Today on The Question Is with Anthony Portantino, I am so pleased to welcome one of the most well-respected open space advocates in our country. He's been called dynamic and shrewd as he leads one of the most influential government agencies in California. His name is Joe Edmiston. Stay tuned to see his passion for his work firsthand. You won't want to miss this show. At a time when many government agencies are mired in gridlock, the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy makes things happen. And the man who makes things happen there is Joe Edmiston, its longtime executive director. Joe is considered to be one of the most influential people in California government. He's an expert on parks and open space, and he's a strong advocate for Proposition 1, the long-sought water bond on the state ballot. You're in for a real treat. Joe, thanks for being here today.
Thank you, Anthony.
So people call the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy the Conservancy because of its preeminent role. How did this all come about?
Well, there was a great fear in the late 70s that the developers would use their D9 caterpillars and just push everything in the Santa Monica Mountains into a nice flat pad and have hundreds of thousands of houses, and all that beauty would be lost forever. So people got together and said, we don't want that to happen.
Well, wait a minute. You got a phone call from a governor today who was governor then. So how did that happen?
Governor Brown was a resident at that time of the Santa Monica Mountains, Laurel Canyon, and we had some discussions, and I was a Sierra Club lobbyist at the time, a young guy, 27, and, you know, he was in favor of appointing young people, and now he's in favor of keeping and retaining people that have lots of experience.
Exactly, I was going to say, that's interesting how time changes perspective, and everything that was old again is new again. So it required state legislation. Howard Berman, I think, was the original author. Was there a planning process in the beginning?
There was a planning process, and the citizens got together, and we had a citizen commission, and we recommended that there be a permanent body to protect the mountains, and that's where the recommendation for the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy came in.
And so Howard Berman introduced legislation, it passed, and then Governor Brown signed it.
Governor Brown signed it. It was very controversial, but there was
because the development interests wanted to keep.
Development interests were dead set against it, but again, you know, it's not so much what any one individual does; it's the fact that we're surfing a wave of public opposition to overdevelopment, and that's really what caused all this to happen.
Right, and so at the time, there was only one other conservancy in the whole state of California, so this was pretty cutting-edge land use planning and government planning.
Right now, we have seven conservancies around the state. Pretty much covers the entire state.
And how much land area does the Santa Monica Mountains? Do you know in acres or in regions? How would you?
Well, the regions have been expanded.
Right.
The acreage is well over a half. Million acres
have been acquired.
Not acquired, but that's the area over which we can operate.
Okay.
And about 71,000 acres have actually been acquired through what we've done.
Right. And then you acquire them, and then you maintain them. Many of them are teaching areas. You have visitor centers.
There are high use recreation areas. We also have almost pure wilderness areas. Lots of hiking. Lots of opportunities for families, for kids. And the thing I'm most proud of, actually, is what we're doing now, which is to improve the LA River and the tributaries to the LA River, Arroyo Seco, up in your communities.
Right, because at some point in our ancient past, they decided to make rivers concrete.
Well, you know, our policy used to be that every drop of water that fell in Northern California and in the Owens Valley had to come as fast as possible down the aqueduct to Los Angeles.
Right.
But every drop of water that fell in the LA Basin had to go as quickly as possible through the flood control channel to the Pacific Ocean. We're now changing that idea, and that's something that we've been in the forefront of doing.
Right, and certainly making a difference. as land use planning took effect, as you said in the beginning, what we talk about today is common sort of things, view preservation, ridge lines, preserving tree, all those things back at that time were not front and center, which is, as a non-native Californian, you always have this picture that people were talking about those things all the time, but that was sort of a renaissance in the mid-70s to really plan for the future.
Yes, but what was really behind it is that the politicians, and pardon the expression, but the politicians were so far behind the people. So it really started in 1972 with the Coastal Initiative. That was a popular initiative. People mm-hmm. went out in front of the supermarkets and got the signatures. And when that came upon and passed pretty much overwhelmingly, people started to think, well, maybe this is a popular issue.
Right.
But the lobbyists and a lot of the development interests still control the California legislature. And
right.
so it was a very difficult task for Howard Berman to get these conservation measures passed.
Right, and of course now they go through much easier.
Now much easier. In fact, that's the reason it was a bipartisan effort to expand the
right.
Conservancy way beyond the Santa Monica Mountains to provide the rim of the valley, which surrounds the San Fernando Valley. And so we started out with about 200,000 acres under our jurisdiction, and now it's over 500,000.
Right, and again, in the 1980s when it was expanded, it was truly bipartisan efforts.
It was bipartisan. Assemblymember Nolan, Assemblymember Margolin, both leaders, respectively, right. the Republican Democratic Party.
And then Congressman Schiff, who was a senator at the time, he then
That's
expanded
right.
it further, and I think that had bipartisan support as well.
It did.
Right.
I always like to say that, we had the former police chief, Ed Davis, was our biggest supporter.
Right.
So he was a tough guy, and he didn't like to expand bureaucracy, but he didn't see us as a bureaucracy, so
right.
that's good.
Well, I think part of that is the reputation of the agency. I mean, you showed the state that it was an effective model. I remember the very first, for full disclosure, I sit on the advisory board of the Conservancy, and I remember my first time being on the Conservancy, my very first meeting, having citizen participants in significant numbers come to the open microphone. I said, this is just like a city council meeting, that the citizen participation is significant in helping you do your mission.
So how many of those did you solicit to come to our meeting?
Only when necessary. As you know, God rest Liz Blackwelder's soul, but she made every time there was some piece of property that she needed to be there to advocate for. She
well,
was there.
See, your participation is an example of what has led to our success. We have this advisory body that represents all the elected
right.
officials in all the city councils in our area. And when we get our best information and ideas, it really comes from the grassroots.
I think you need to explain that a little bit. There's two boards, and it really does facilitate citizen participation. There's the board, and then there's the advisory board, and they meet concurrently. Who came up with that idea? How did that come
well,
up?
Well, that actually came up from the members of the board itself. They said, we want to have the maximum number of people giving us input, giving us good ideas.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was the genesis of it. And we have, I think, 26 members of the advisory board now.
Right.
We always have a quorum, and we always have good ideas. And
right.
the so-called board, that's composed of state officials mm-hmm. and state-appointed officials, also County of Los Angeles, Ventura County. And I won't say that they rubber stamp, because they're not a rubber stamp, but they get a lot of their ideas from the advisory
right.
committee.
Now, it is a unique model, and having representatives from all of the local jurisdictions, I mean, obviously one thing as a policymaker we always struggle with is the right balance between local control, state intervention, and this sort of does hit the sweet spot, because you do have, like for example, the city of Glendale's representative is from their parks department. In La Cañada Flint Ridge, I'm a former council member and I'm the representative. In Pasadena, it's a member of the planning commission. And so the local representation is really plugged into local needs, and it makes it a very effective model.
And one thing that people were concerned about to have this structure was, would parochialism govern? would people in La Cañada Flint Ridge say, all for us and nothing for Thousand Oaks, or that kind of thing. And that has not happened. In fact, one of the most gratifying things has been there's no parochialism.
Whenever I wouldn't say there's no parochialism.
Well, you know what?
It's very minimal.
It's minimal.
It's very minimal.
People are advocating their positions.
Right.
But you wouldn't bring to us a project that wasn't meritorious.
Correct.
And the rest of the board understands that.
Right.
So.
No, I think the model works. The only reason why I laugh is, I don't know if you remember, but I think it was my second meeting when Prop 12 was passed. I said, why don't we divide it by six and give each region the same amount of money, and that was not well received, because now we have to look at each project on its own merit. We can't do it. But you are correct in that the regions work very closely together, and there's a lot of healthy respect. And again, I think it goes back to you take time doing the tours of each potential property. I mean, we don't just buy and sell or buy in a vacuum. I mean, there's a lot of due diligence that goes into justifying each purchase.
Exactly. We don't have all that much money.
Right.
And we have to get the best bang for the buck.
Right. No, and that is definitely 100% true. So you get created. Initially, were you funded as part of that legislation, or were there subsequent bonds that came about that created?
There were subsequent bonds.
Right.
So pretty much every natural resources bond since 1980 on has had a component for the Conservancy,
right.
Sometimes a very significant component. And most recently, it came by initiative. Proposition 40 and Proposition 84
right.
were both popular citizens' initiatives. Now we have the opportunity with Proposition 1, which we'll talk about later, to actually have that via the legislature.
Right. And I think that's important, too, because the propositions and the initiatives have had financial resources, but also strict accountability, strict protocols, what qualifies, what doesn't qualify, watershed versus non-watershed, urban versus, I mean, it's really been, you know, one of the reasons why I'm excited to have you on here is people talk about, you know, the failings, you know, the Golden Gate Bridge or whatever it is, but this is where it's really working, because it's that combination of state and local working together.
Well, I don't think that there's any question but that we would not be able to do what we can do if we had the same kinds of, look, if we had everybody looking over our shoulder like an engineer. Right now we have the green eyeshade guys up in the Department of Finance looking over everything.
Right.
But the main advantage that we have is we have the citizens behind us.
Right.
Okay? And the citizens know what they want. And when you have that kind of public support, then the bureaucrats have to back down.
Right. And I think that was something you said early, interesting about the citizens were ahead of the policymakers.
Absolutely.
Californians knew what they wanted.
Exactly.
And they wanted places to hike. They wanted views that were beautiful. They wanted to maintain the sort of the golden, the luster of California. And they spoke.
Yeah.
And you were created.
I mean, if you ask many of the people who've come from other areas, particularly frigid parts of the U.S., and how come you came to Southern California? Well, we've got the mountains and the beaches and Hollywood and everything in between all in one spot, and it doesn't snow. And when you put all that together, people said, we don't want those mountains to be bulldozed. And that was the reason that we have the organization.
You mentioned Hollywood. There's a lot of filming that goes on in Conservancy property.
Absolutely. I love it. I go to the show and I will, you know, nudge my wife and says, oh, I know where that is. That was our thing. And, you know, she kind of gets kind of irritated when I do that.
Well, years ago in my other life, I was actually a location manager and we filmed on your property off of Mulholland. We did we had a car crash. It was into a pig pen and it was all done on Conservancy property. So it always makes me smile whenever I drive by that sign on the way to the Suki Goldman Center that I filmed there. As a pup filmmaker.
You so. Filmed the pig pen.
I filmed the pig pen on state property.
Okay.
With a permit, of course.
Good. I hope we charged a lot for that.
You did. So we're going to come back in our next segment, and we're going to talk about Proposition 1, because obviously there's the Conservancy piece to Proposition 1, which is good news for those of us who want to preserve our open space, but there's also desperately needed water.
Absolutely.
And so in our next segment, we're going to discuss Proposition 1, which is on the ballot next month, And so please tune in and stay with us on The Question Is with Anthony Portantino with my great guest, Joe Edmiston.
When Dennis Walker was in high school, his locker partner, Dave, stole his girlfriend. And Dennis realized Dave was not his friend. When Dennis got satellite, he also got an unreliable signal. And he realized satellite was not his friend. Now he has Charter and a reliable weatherproof signal, just like thousands of others who switch every month. Take it from Dennis, satellite is not your friend. Get a reliable signal, rain or shine, with Charter.
We're back on The Question Is with Anthony Portantino with my guest, Joe Edmiston from the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy. We've talked a lot about how the Conservancy was created and how it's, you know, relied on bonds and other state funding to do the wonderful works it's doing. On the ballot next month is Proposition 1. And Joe, you're a big supporter of Proposition 1. I know the Conservancy
Absolutely.
Supports Proposition 1. Walk us through, you know, Water Policy 101 in California.
Well, the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy is a state agency. Mm-hmm. We're not out to propagandize anybody. But looking at the actual facts of the issue, we're in a drought. We're in a drought that could last a generation.
Right.
And we have ignored that. We've said, as long as water keeps coming down from Northern California, we don't have to worry about it in Southern California. Well, now we have to worry.
Right.
We're not going to have the same amount of beauty in California if everything is literally dried up. And I went and looked at some of the, looked at Folsom Reservoir, for example, outside of Sacramento. Mm-hmm. And it's a dry lake bed. Mm-hmm. So nature is going through its cycles. And if we have a continued drought, California lifestyle isn't going to be California lifestyle anymore.
Not to mention the historical crops in the Central Valley that a decade ago were suffering from water shortages. And, you know, a lot of the farmers and the workforce rely on that. I know there's some communities with 40-45% unemployment rates.
Right, and California agriculture has become steadily more productive and more economically viable.
Right.
We used to have a problem. People were saying, would there be a future for California agriculture? Now we're going into more profitable crops, nuts and pistachios and right. almonds and all of that. And that helps the labor situation. People have good jobs as a result of California agriculture. We won't have that if we don't have water.
Right. And anybody who saw the movie Chinatown knows that the one scene where the farmers bring their goats into the city hall, you know, they were fighting about these issues in the 40s. Obviously, the legislature had an $11 billion bond that I actually voted for a few years ago that never made it to the ballot. It was time it was way past time that these issues go before the voters to get solved.
Well, 11 point whatever it was billion was viewed as just too expensive.
Right, it was too big.
And the governor really did us a service by saying to the legislature, we need a water bond, but we need one that is slimmed down.
Right.
And so legislature responded on that. A lot of leadership by Senator Fran Pavley, Senator Steinberg,
right.
The assembly leadership. And so now we have a bond that's $7.1 billion in new spending.
Right.
The total amount is $7.5. They took some spending from a previous proposition. And that's pretty much halfway for water storage and more water, and the other part, water conservation. And right. that's a good balance.
Right. And I think that's important for people to understand, that there really is a balance in Proposition 1. I mean, some people don't want more storage. Some people want all our eggs to go into conservation, new technology, and other methods. And the farmers certainly want a dedicated, stable water supply and believe storage is the way to get there. And so Governor Brown pretty much got everybody in the room and said, you're all going to get half of what you want, and you're going to like it, and we're going to make this happen, and it's actually going to pass.
Well, you know, this contradicts the laws of mathematics, because everybody got about three-quarters of what they wanted, okay? So there was enough overlap, and you raise a very good point here, because when there's leadership, such as Governor Brown's
right.
leadership, then all things kind of fall into place.
Right.
And he was able to say, what's your number one and two priorities? And ask that of everyone. And they gave it, and he says, okay, three and four you may have to compromise on, one and two you get.
Right.
And that's the way we make public policy. We used to do it And now we're making, and I think that Proposition 1 may be the harbinger of good things to come in terms of Republicans and Democrats figuring out what they have in common.
Right, because it was a truly bipartisan.
Absolutely.
Everybody held hands and I think happily voted for it, not begrudgingly. And, you know, contrasting that to what happened, you know, 5 years ago or 4 years ago. And at that time, the governor had a different approach. It was, what do I need from you to make this happen? What do I need from you?
And well, it was a different governor.
It was a different governor.
Yeah.
Totally different governor and a different approach. And we used to say every day there was a new ornament on the tree because, you know, somebody wanted something and he just said yes to everybody. Now, at the end of the day, the crisis was so great that many of us felt we had no choice because to keep delaying it, the cost would go up. And so, you know, got a majority. And again, it was somewhat bipartisan. But it was too big.
It was too big. And we had an economic crisis in the country.
Right.
And people were not voting for new expenditures.
Walk us through some of the competitive grant elements of Prop 1 and how that relates to Southern California, Northern California. You know, walk us through some of that.
Well, there's an important thing. There's a rule in this bond that there's no specific itemization.
Right.
So there's no question about pork barrel or anything
right.
like that.
Nobody earmarked anything.
No earmarks.
Right.
Okay? That was a fundamental. And the competitive grant process means that the best projects come to the top.
Right.
And they have to be evaluated. There's public participation. So we all know nobody's playing hide the pea under the walnut shell.
Right. And I think that's important because people want to know the projects that get created or greenlit are the most laudable projects.
And some people have wondered, how are we going to get more water if we put money into Southern California? Well, the simple fact is that it does rain, and we do have runoff, and we have all that water that comes down from Northern California goes into the aquifers. Some of it goes into the various sewage treatment plants, Hyperion and everything. And what we need to do is take, for example, the LA River. We need to have more of that infiltrating into
right.
the aquifers. It gets cleaned up naturally. So if we can do more here in Southern California, we won't have to
import.
Suck Northern California dry.
Right. And I think that's important. And that's where the conservation element comes in. And that's where some of the regional fairness comes into. Now, it's also delta neutral.
That's right.
Which is an important point for people who were worried about, you know, good, bad, and different.
Right. The big controversy is, are these water projects going to harm the fish and wildlife and the farmers in the Delta? And I think it's very important that Senator Wolk, who was an opponent of the previous measure,
right.
strong opponent, she actually carried the bill. She mm-hmm. carried the bill in the Senate to make this thing happen because it is something as so-called Delta neutral. If you're not a wonk, you won't understand what that means. It just means it's not going to hurt the Delta.
Right. And there's also groundwater cleanup and contamination pieces to it as well. I mean, there's conservation, there's storage, there's cleanup. And that has an impact for Southern California because that's where some of the wells that need the cleanup, too.
That's right. We used to be able to subsist on what we pulled out of the ground ourselves.
Right.
And in fact, here in the San Gabriel Valley, still a very significant portion of the water that's used comes from underground sources.
Yeah, I know my colleagues in the San Gabriel Valley were hoping for a little bit more, but they can also apply for some of the competitive grants as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so I'm hopeful that the San Gabriel Valley gets some of the competitive grants, and I know there are a lot of folks, you know, good folks working on trying to do what we can, because the San Gabriel Valley does have its issues with groundwater contamination, and I'd like to see long-term more efforts done there.
Well,
but
we get experienced legislators elected to office and from San Gabriel Valley, and I think that will happen.
Right, and our own Assemblymember Anthony Rendon is the chair of the Water Parks and Wildlife Committee, and I know he was advocating very strongly on that, as well as Senator Hernandez. So it came together, the governor's leadership. It's on the ballot next month. A lot of the opposition is pretty quiet because most of the concerns have been addressed because of the fiscal responsibility and the well-crafted nature of it. Do you see a tough election battle ahead? How do you see the tea leaves as you travel around the state?
I don't see a tough election battle. I think it's the need is pretty much self-evident.
Right.
If you travel up and down the state, I was just driving on the 5, and it's obvious. We need Proposition 1. Right. There's no question. I looked at the internet this morning. The opponents have raised only $76,000 against it. The proponents have raised, I think, over $6 million. Because really everybody from the League of Conservation Voters to the various water agencies are all coalescing together. I've never seen that before, Anthony.
Right. Now, and you know, the other interesting thing is it's really renewed the general public's interest in non-native plants and in, you know, front yards are changing in California. And I think people are really putting a lot of thought, a lot of effort. I was in Claremont recently, and I've never seen that many, you know, wonderfully sculptured front yards that are all, you know, drought tolerant and beautiful.
You know, I grew up in a conservation family, as you know,
right.
But I had the job of mowing the lawn. And I didn't know about drought tolerant plants.
Right.
Boy, I sure would have told my parents, plant succulents so I don't have to mow the lawn.
Well, that's something you and I share. I grew up in New Jersey, and one of my jobs was mowing the lawn as well. And there was no thought of ever having anyone else, you know. My father used to say, I have 3 sons, you're doing the work. And that was it. But so it's going to be on the ballot. Hopefully the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy will share in some of the competitive grants, but the other conservancies around the state have that opportunity. Local
Absolutely.
Municipalities
Absolutely.
Are going to get a piece of this as well.
Absolutely.
Anything that you see going, what's the next step? Let's say this passes. What do you see as the next step?
I see the next step as the citizens around the state getting together. We're going to have hearings all over the state.
Mm-hmm.
Every agency has to have statewide hearings.
Mm-hmm.
People are going to be recommending what the projects ought to be. And I think the exciting thing is here in Southern California, some of the most impacted communities are near our rivers.
Right.
And we can have new park areas. They'll look like new parks. What they really will be is multifunction. So that the water is infiltrated, cleaned up. But to the kid who's riding their bike to this neighborhood park, it just looks like a neighborhood park. And that's what we want.
Now, the interesting thing for me, you know, we've talked sort of around the fringes of, you know, bipartisan and cooperation. And times have changed because it was Richard Nixon who signed the Clean Water Act. Your agency.
And the Clean Air Act.
And the Clean Air Act.
Environmental Policy Act.
Right. We have to sort of get out of our trenches both on both sides and say, all right, everybody wants clean air, everybody wants clean water, everybody wants, you know, vegetables on the table that come from California growers. How do we make it happen? And it seems like Governor Brown has found the magic bullet to make some of those policy decisions happen at the top level, and I think California is going to be better off for it.
It will be.
Yeah.
I mean, if we get this measure passed when all the other measures floundered, I think Governor Brown is going to go down in history as a progressive governor and as a worthy successor and possibly even supersede his dad's record.
I think that notion right there would bring a smile to his face. Before we run out of time, I want to go back to the Conservancy real quick. What do you think is the when you sit down in your chair, what piece of property, what parcel, what hillside are you the most proud of preserving in your tenure as the executive director of the Conservancy?
Well, you know, I think the thing that we've done that has influenced people the most is when we took this old pipe yard down in South Central Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
And we took the pipes out of it. It was where the pipe went to die for the DWP. And we put a beautiful 8.5-acre park down there that looks like it was transplanted from the Santa Monica Mountains down to South Central Los Angeles. And every weekend we took kids up to the mountains from there and said,
right.
You want to see the real thing? We do that now at a place called Vista Hermosa, which is just west of downtown LA, one of the most impacted communities in Los Angeles. We created, again, a beautiful mountain environment right next to poverty.
In 10 seconds, tell me about how many kids, school children a year from Los Angeles, you think come to one of your education centers.
Education centers and the whole program is about, I would say, at least 100,000 kids benefit from the things that we've done every year.
100,000 kids every year, that's going to be generations of...
But it's not enough.
It's not enough. Pass Prop 1. Vote yes on Prop 1, and get involved in your local Conservancy. It's been a pleasure to have Joe Edmiston here on board with us at the Question Is with Anthony Portantino. Come back next month, vote yes on Prop 1 in November.